131st anniversary of Franklin Roosevelt's birth. So a very significant day. So we can consider this a birthday party of sorts. And I do hope you will all stay for the reception that comes after our program. It's my pleasure to welcome you to a very special conversation between Kirk Semple of the New York Times and former U.S. Attorney Robert Morgenthau on justice for immigrants. In a moment, I'll introduce Judge Robert Katzmann of the U.S. Court of Appeals for the Second Circuit, who will frame the issues and introduce our guests. We're in the historic homes of Eleanor and Franklin Roosevelt and Franklin's mother, Sarah. The Roosevelts lived here from 1908 when Sarah built the houses and gave Eleanor and Franklin that part, number 49, as a wedding gift, and they lived here until they left for the White House in early 1933. The steady flow of visitors to these homes, the lively conversation on issues of the day, the trials of polio, and the triumphant return to politics as governor and president all shaped their worldview. It was here where the New Deal was planned, where cabinet officers like Francis Perkins were recruited, where Social Security and other programs found their design and commitment. And if you have a chance, do go upstairs to the second floor on this side and see Franklin Roosevelt's study, where much of this took place. And it's a very special honor to be in the presence of Robert Morgenthau, who knew Franklin and Eleanor. And in fact, if I'm right, behind you is a Yalta picture of Winston Churchill, Franklin Roosevelt, and Joseph Stalin, and I know you know at least two of those, if not all three. When Sarah died in 1941, Franklin and Eleanor made it possible for Hunter to purchase the homes for an interfaith student center. But the houses were closed in disrepair in 1992, and they remained boarded up until Hunter President Jennifer Rabb, through courage and determination, raised the funds to get them reopened and had the vision to create this public policy institute. And central to the purpose of this institute is to sponsor programs on critical issues of our time so the general public can talk to each other and engage with policymakers. So I think Franklin and Eleanor would be very pleased that we're gathered here tonight to talk about justice for immigrants. And I want you to listen now to Franklin's words in October 1940, a radio address to the Herald Tribune Forum. He spoke about how much immigrants had contributed to our country. This is Franklin now speaking. "These varied Americans with varied backgrounds are all immigrants or descendants of immigrants. All of them are inheritors of the same stalwart tradition, a tradition of unusual enterprise, of adventurousness, of courage to pull up stakes and get moving. That has been the great compelling force in our history. Our continent, our hemisphere, has been populated by people who wanted a better life than the life they had previously known. They were willing to undergo all conceivable perils, all conceivable hardships to achieve the better life. They were animated, just as we are animated by this compelling force today. It is what makes us Americans. They built a system in which government and people are one, a nation which is a partnership and can continue as a partnership. That is our strength today." Said in 1940 on his birthday, we hear those words, and they still really inspire us, don't they? So I think President Roosevelt would have been proud to have appointed the person I get to introduce, Robert Katzmann, to the federal bench. He is a scholar and a practitioner, receiving his JD from Yale and his PhD in government from Harvard, where he studied with Daniel Patrick Moynihan. At the time of his appointment in 1999 by President Clinton to the Second Circuit, he was the Walsh Professor of Government, Law, and Public Policy at Georgetown, a fellow and acting program director at Brookings, and the president of the Governance Institute. On September 1st, he becomes Chief Judge of the Second Circuit here in New York. He has published books on the Federal Trade Commission, on transportation policy for the disabled, the law firm and public good, on Congress and the courts, and on his mentor, Senator Moynihan. He is a fellow of the American Academy of Arts and Sciences. In 2007, he gave the Marden Lecture at the Association of the Bar of the City of New York about the unmet needs of the immigrant poor. It was rich in evidence about how poorly immigrants facing deportation are treated by both administrative and judicial arms of our government. And it was a clarion call for reform. A year later, he convened a study group on immigrant deportation made up of 50 leading lawyers in private practice, leaders of immigrant service organizations, government officials, and more. It commissioned a New York immigrant population study which documented some shocking facts. For example, that 60% of detained immigrants do not have counsel by the time their cases are completed, 60%. And maybe that's why our government expelled 1,100 immigrants every day last April. Judge Katzmann will tell you more about the findings and concrete remedies that the study group recommended. For Bob Katzmann, immigrant rights are very personal. On accepting the Learned Hand Medal for the Federal Bar Council last year, he said, and I quote, "We are all shaped by our personal histories. As I reflect on my subject tonight, immigrant representation, my own family's past no doubt plays a part. My father is a refugee from Nazi persecution, my mother the child of Russian immigrants. I can still hear the accents and voices of my own relatives who escaped persecution, who wanted to become part of this great country, and who, through their toil and belief in the American dream, made this great nation even greater. When we work to secure adequate representation for immigrants, not only are we faithful to our own professional responsibilities, not only do we further the fair and effective administration of justice, but we also honor this nation's immigrant experience." Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Robert Katzmann.
Thank you, Jonathan. It's a privilege to be introduced by you, having so long admired your many contributions to higher education, to the foundation world, to your active engagement in so many causes, domestic and abroad, in a variety of capacities. And it's a privilege to be at Roosevelt House and to be a member of its advisory board. When I first became a judge in 1999, the immigration docket of the Second Circuit was minuscule, just a couple of percent. And within a few years, the docket had escalated, especially in the post 9/11 period, to something like 40% of our docket. And in case after case, I was struck by the absolutely abysmal quality of representation for immigrants. And in case after case, I had the feeling that if only the immigrant had better counsel, the result would have been different, because by the time a case gets to us, our review at the Court of Appeals is very limited. And so that having counsel at the very outset of immigration proceedings is so critically important, because we're talking about a very vulnerable population of people who come to this country often in fear, often in poverty, not knowing the language, not knowing to whom to turn, and who are easy prey for those who are unscrupulous. And so that really motivated me to create the study group on immigrant representation that Jonathan Fanton has described. We have a dozen initiatives, and if there are any foundation officials here, I'd love to see you in the in the reception. But let me just reference a couple of things in the data. Jonathan made reference to the study that we performed. It's a two-part study New York Immigrant Representation Study. Lindsay Nash, who was very much a part of that work, is here with us today. And the statistics, as Jonathan said, are really quite staggering. This is the first time that we ever had really, really good data. Senator Moynihan used to say that you're entitled to your opinion, but not your own facts. So we went out and we got the facts through work with the Vera Institute of Justice. As Jonathan said, 60% of detained immigrants do not have counsel at the time that their cases are completed. 27% of non-detained immigrants do not have counsel by the time their cases are completed. The two most important variables affecting the ability to secure a successful outcome in a case defined as relief or termination are having representation and being free from detention. So represented and released or never detained, 74% have successful outcomes. That shows you the power of having a decent lawyer. Unrepresented but released or never detained, 13% have successful outcomes. Represented but detained, 18% have successful outcomes. Unrepresented and detained, 3% have successful outcomes. The second year of our report, which Kirk Semple reported on, describes some of our efforts to come to some sort of solutions to that effort, to that problem. And we have a number of, I have a number of different dreams, like the creation of a law corps, a law and justice corps, that would bring senior lawyers and young lawyers together in kind of a Peace Corps or a VISTA Corps to work on the immigration problem. And we've got so many ideas, and because of this wonderful group of 50 lawyers. It is in the course of that work that I had the privilege of coming to know Robert Morgenthau and Kirk Semple. First, some words about Robert Morgenthau. To anyone who has been in public service, as I have been, Robert Morgenthau is the gold standard. His brilliant resume is known to all of us here as a legendary New York County DA for 35 years, as United States Attorney in the Southern District of New York for 8 years. He enlisted in World War II in the Navy, serving for 4.5 years with final rank as a Lieutenant Commander, seeing action in the Pacific and Mediterranean theaters. The very name Robert Morgenthau evokes powerful professional powerful values, and these are some: professional excellence, integrity, vision, leadership, a lifetime of commitment to public service, a passion for the fair and effective administration of justice, a tireless devotion to veterans, the Police Athletic League, the Museum of Jewish Heritage. He has been a mentor to so many lawyers and government officials who view their association with him as the high point of their professional lives. My former colleague, Sonia Sotomayor, in her new book, My Beloved World, writes of the critical importance to her career of having been selected by Mr. Morgenthau to work in the Manhattan DA's office. And my friend, Peter Kugasian, who is here tonight and worked with Mr. Morgenthau for 30 years, had this to say, and I quote, "To those who have worked under Robert Morgenthau, his passion for the rights of immigrants is but an extension of his abiding concern for fundamental freedoms and the well-being of the least powerful among us." I have come to know, as I said, Robert Morgenthau through this immigration connection. As Manhattan DA, he was a pioneer creating a unit to combat immigration fraud. While he could have rested on his laurels at Wachtell Lipton, he's devoted much of his prodigious energies in the service of immigrants. He has been relentless in speaking truth to power, in pressing for justice for immigrants. I don't know of anyone who has been more engaged in these issues than he. His op-eds are read at the highest levels of government. He is, for me, an inspiration because of who he is, what he has stood for, what he stands for, what he has achieved. We continue to look to Robert Morgenthau for guidance. And I always consider it a fortunate day for me when I've had the benefit of his thinking. Tonight will be a gift to all of us as we hear him speak about justice for immigrants. Mr. Morgenthau will be in conversation with Kirk Semple of the New York Times, whose byline is familiar to all of us. Kirk Semple has worked for the New York Times since 2003 and is currently a reporter for the Metro Desks, covering immigration and immigrant communities in the New York region. He has held various positions in the paper's Metro, national, and foreign staffs. He covered the war in Iraq and has reported from Afghanistan, Haiti, and the United Nations. From 97 to 2003, Kirk Semple was a freelance correspondent based in Bogota, Colombia. For those of us concerned about justice for immigrants, Kirk Semple's reporting has been indispensable. He has shown a spotlight on the problems of immigrants, ensuring that their plight will not be ignored, giving hope that attention will be paid. I can attest that he covers stories that would go unreported on matters of critical importance, and that in that coverage, he not only informs, but stimulates critical thinking. Because of him, the challenges facing immigrants, this vulnerable population, are better understood and the subject of serious public discourse, as they should be. His keen intellect brings a freshness to the issues. His reporting inspires confidence because of his accuracy, thoroughness, fairness, and the clarity of his prose. As I read his extraordinary reporting about immigrant communities across New York, I am reminded of the writing of the late Oscar Hanlon, whose work some 60 years ago, The Uprooted, tried to capture the unique experiences and voices of different immigrant communities. Like Hanlon, Kirk Semple's writings present the hearts, souls, and challenges of today's immigrants. All of us here are in Kirk's debt for his exemplary reporting and to the New York Times for its commitment to reporting on immigration issues. And with that, I will leave it to Mr. Semple and Mr. Morgenthau.
Thank you. Thank you, Judge Katzmann. I'm humbled by that introduction. Thank you, Jonathan, for introducing us as well, and for the invitation to participate in this event. And Mr. Morgenthau, it's an honor to be here with you. This session comes at an auspicious time. There's been a flurry of activity, unparalleled activity, and suddenly, just in the last few days in Washington, the timing of today's event, which was, of course, planned weeks and weeks ago, makes me wonder whether we're simply experiencing a happy coincidence or seeing evidence of Jonathan Fanton's extraordinary, almost divine prescience. Mr. Morgenthau, you have written eloquently over the past few years about flaws in our immigration system, and your arguments for reform seem driven as much by morality and a sense of history as by practical concerns. In a column in the Daily News 3 years ago, you wrote, quote, "We seem to have lost sight of the spirit of our immigration laws." And in another piece, you wrote that the key to dealing with the system is, quote, "Above all, remember that we are a nation of immigrants." That, of course, that phrase, a nation of immigrants, is a phrase that Obama employed yesterday in his speech. How, in your opinion, have we strayed from the intended spirit of our immigration laws?
By and large, we've treated immigrants very harshly. The law is extremely difficult, but its administration, I think, over the years, and not just recently, has been very anti-immigrant. And I just think that we've forgotten that we're a nation of immigrants. We've forgotten the mission of this country to welcome immigrants. And I think it's extremely regrettable.
Do you believe there's a moral case for comprehensive immigration reform, for changing the system?
I mean, I think we got to remember the opportunities that our parents or grandparents had in this country, and we got to make sure that this generation of immigrants have the same opportunities as we and our families had. I mean, we're a nation of immigrants, and we should never forget that.
What are we not doing to welcome immigrants to accommodate?
We've got all these technical violations. Students have overstayed their student visa by a couple of weeks, or arrested if they try to come back into this country. I first became aware, really, of how, I would say, absurd the laws and their enforcement were back in 2003, when the daughter of Costa-Gavras, who was a distinguished Greek film director and producer, and he was directing a program at Lincoln Center on Greek culture. And she came over to be with him for the 5 days of that program. She's arrested on arrival at JFK on the ground that she had overstayed a visitor's visa 10 years earlier. He was Greek. She had French citizenship because her mother was French. So the French ambassador, the Greek ambassador, many other people all called on her behalf. And the immigration people said, you know, the law's the law. She overstayed her visa.
Where was she being held at that moment?
At JFK. She's got to stay in detention until she gets on a plane back to Paris. She had a return trip booked 5 days later. I happened to be out there at JFK, and a mutual friend called me, and I went to see the immigration officer in charge, and he started giving me the same talk. The law's the law. Sorry, she violated the law 10 years ago, and we can't let her set foot. She was clearly a danger to the American society. I finally said to him, why don't you treat her like a common criminal? Parole her in my custody, and I'll be responsible for seeing that she's on a plane back to Paris in 5 days. So he thought about it, and then closed the door, he made some calls, and he finally reluctantly said, all right, she can stay for 5 days. But, I mean, that brought home to me how ridiculous the law was and how even more ridiculous its enforcement was.
I feel duty-bound as a journalist to challenge a couple of your assertions here, with all due respect. You mentioned the case, for instance, of somebody returning after having been deported once. How do you answer the critics of reform and critics of those of efforts to be more lenient in specific cases, who argue that without the law we would be overrun by people coming in from overseas? Are you proposing a change in the law? Are you saying that the door should be wider?
Yeah, I think the door should be wider. I think there's got to be a pathway to citizenship for people who are here, hold jobs, law-abiding citizens. I mean, for two reasons. One is we owe it to immigrants, and two, we need them. We need them. Whether it's scientific work or labor on the farm or in hotels and restaurants, we need those immigrants, and it's extremely short-sighted to lock them up and try to send them back. plus the fact that, I mean, it's, this has been the gateway for thousands and thousands of people. And I think we've forgotten our mission when we say, you know, we don't want immigrants. This has been the home for immigrants from the whole history of this country.
When is deportation acceptable to you? When is detention, and deportation acceptable to you?
Well, I think only if somebody has been convicted of a serious crime. But, I mean, the study showed that the people who are being deported, 90% of them have committed no crimes. So I think it's fitting when we're here in Roosevelt House to read what Mrs. Roosevelt, said. She said, "We Americans are well aware that this is not a one-sided relationship. We are offering you a home and a haven, to be sure. However, you are bringing us your skills, your talents, and your cultures. We are grateful to you for broadening our scope and enriching our country, which consists of newcomers just like you." They're a big asset to this country, and we're cutting off our nose, despite our face, when we exclude them.
You alluded to the indiscreet application of the law, among the myriad problems in the system, you have taken particular issue with the Secure Communities Program administered by the Department of Homeland Security and the Detainer Program. What's wrong with those programs? And perhaps we should explain what those programs are.
Homeland Security said that was going to be a voluntary program.
This is the Secure Communities Program.
Secure Communities, done by the federal government in conjunction with the communities.
Mr. Morgenthau, let me explain to those in the audience who aren't familiar with Secure Communities what the program is, because it's been a real flashpoint of immigration policy. This was a program that was begun under the George W. Bush and then continued by the Obama administration. And the Obama administration has made it a cornerstone of its enforcement strategy. And what it essentially does is it ties the Department of Homeland Security's databases into the FBI's databases, the national database, so that when an immigrant is booked by a local law enforcement agency, the federal immigration officials can check those fingerprints against the immigration fingerprint databases. And if they find a match of a suspect, somebody they suspect is in the country illegally or a non-citizen with a criminal record, they may issue a detainer. And that is essentially a request to the local police, the local law enforcement agency, to hold on to that person for pickup later by the federal immigration authorities.
Well, the problem with that program is that when somebody's been arrested, the prints are then sent to the FBI, who then sends them to Homeland Security. Before there's been any evaluation by an assistant DA, by a prosecutor, before that person has appeared in court and a decision has been made whether it's a valid arrest. And in New York City, 40% of the people who are arrested have their arrests dismissed. But those names are still in the database. And Homeland Security bragged that under this program, 16 million prints were sent to Homeland Security, and 900,000 of them many match. Well, that's like 1 in 6, but there's no provision if those cases are dismissed, and 40% of them will be dismissed, no provision to clean those files, to get rid of that taint on somebody's record. So if they try to take advantage of like the deferred education program, anything else, they may have an arrest for making an illegal right turn. And the case has been dismissed, but that's still on the record, and they'll be denied the ability to take advantage of our program. So I think that no fingerprints should go to the FBI or to the Homeland Security until somebody is convicted of a crime. You know,
Do you mean just fingerprints of immigrants or all fingerprints?
Anybody. It's I think it's just wrong to put those in a database before the defendant has just been evaluated by a prosecutor, appeared before a judge, and the judge has found it's a valid arrest. 40% of the arrests in New York City are dismissed, but those 40% stay in the FBI files and in Homeland Security files.
Is there a conversation about this in the legal community? About changing the system whereby fingerprints...
Well, I think a lot of people think it ought to be changed. One of the reasons why I think a program like this is important, because I think a lot of people just don't realize what's going on. I mean, you know, I've said that lawyers should try their cases in court, but this is one instance where there needs to be a public exposure, because I don't think people have any idea of the magnitude of this problem. I mean, the other thing is, if the defendant wants to make bail or his case is dismissed, he may be picked up still by Homeland Security. So it has all kinds of unexpected consequences, and it also makes people in the immigrant community extremely unwilling to cooperate with the law enforcement where it's needed. I mean, I can give an example of that from my own experience. A man held himself out as not only a lawyer, but a lawyer that worked for Homeland Security. And he took cash from undocumented immigrants who had jobs, said, I'll get your green card. And we prosecuted him, convicted him, but in the course of his activities, he had written to Homeland Security giving the names, addresses, and jobs of his clients. So as soon as our case was over, they immediately brought removal proceedings of those people who had cooperated to put this bum in jail. And when I talked to Homeland Security about it, they said, no, there's no provision of the law that we can help you. I've been following that, and I understand that, fortunately, a couple of judges with common sense dismiss those charges, but the Homeland Security wouldn't dismiss them.
Well, presumably, something like that shouldn't happen now in light of John Morton's prosecutorial discretion memo. And John Morton is the head of Immigration and Customs Enforcement, which is an arm of the Department of Homeland Security. A couple of years ago, he issued a memo that's come to be known as the prosecutorial discretion memo, which basically said that laid out the immigration enforcement priorities for the federal government. And the focus of those efforts, he said, would mostly be those illegal immigrants convicted of serious crimes or posing a threat to public safety, as well as those who had been deported and returned illegally. But the application of that, of the prosecutorial discretion memo has been uneven at best. Is that right?
I mean, that, in various forms, that's been issued under three presidents. And under three presidents, it's been ignored.
What were the other two presidents?
I'm sorry?
Who were the other two presidents who issued
Clinton and George Bush. So, I mean, in 2011, this is an example, the whole year, I mean, they said priority is going to be cases of national security and public safety. There are exactly two cases on national security. Both cases, the court denied the exclusion of these immigrants. And in one case, they actually decided that the immigrants should be admitted. But out of 400,000 cases, you find two on national security. So it's a, the statements have been very good, but the policy has not been followed.
This might be a good time to take a look at some of your PowerPoint slides.
Sure.
If you'd like.
Sure.
Okay.
I mean, I just mentioned, yes, I'd like to do that. Okay. I mean, only 4% of the cases have been dismissed under prosecutorial discretion. And the number of pending cases has gone up every year.
Well, the prosecutorial discretion is supposed to be operating both at the street level in the detention of immigrants and also in the court system with a supposedly a thorough review of all pending immigration cases. But that process has been going pretty slowly. Should we take a look at the,
sure.
the PowerPoint slides? This is the aliens removed and returned. Over the course of the last 100+ years, the deportations and removals.
You will see there that if you look at it, it wasn't until like 1944 that the number of deportations really jumped up. But we got along right, and this country was safe from 1892 to 1942 with only a couple of thousand deportations a year. But somebody decided that we got a lot of dangerous people here, we better get rid of them. I spoke to a federal judge, and I said, Sister Court, last night, and he said, you know, if the current laws were in effect when my family came over here, I wouldn't be here today.
Want to move through the slides?
Sure.
Okay. Can we go to the next one, please?
Focusing on national security cases.
National security and serious crimes.
Right.
Yeah.
And then on criminal, it was a big 14%. Immigration only 83.8%, which shows that the focus, despite all the talk on people who were a danger to public safety and national security, were a small fraction of those deported. What we got next?
This is the ranking of charges. Here you go.
This shows the most serious charges for those with, quote, criminal convictions. One, driving under influence of liquor. Two, another traffic offense. Three, marijuana possession. Four, cocaine possession. Five, dangerous drugs. Well, these are the dangerous criminals that they wanted to deport. The result of this has been the immigration court backlog has steadily grown up, and you'll see now stands at about 323,000 cases. But in the last 5 years, the number of pending cases in the immigration court has gone up steadily. And I say CISRA court, as Judge Katzmann will tell you, I mean, it's been inundated with immigration cases. Well, this just gives the court backlog, and at the end of fiscal 2012, pending cases was 325,000. It's gone up steadily every year. as could be expected, the average wait time has gone up every year. And in 2000, well, the first 3 months of this fiscal year, it was 545 days. The whole fiscal 2012 was 531 days.
So it's worth pointing out that over the same period of time, the number of deportations has skyrocketed, and we're now at record levels above 400,000 a year.
And this one shows that the much-advertised prosecutorial discretion was that they only disposed of 4.1% of the pending cases by prosecutorial discretion. And these closures were taking an average of 885 days. And those closed in December, the average time pending was 1,011 cases. And these are cases where the Homeland Security has decided they should be dismissed. But it took 1,011 days to reach that decision. And this figure I find incredible. In fiscal year 2012, the spending on immigration enforcement, including ICE, Customs and Border Patrol, reached nearly $18 billion. This amount exceeds by approximately 24% total spending for the FBI, the Drug Enforcement Administration, the Secret Service, the U.S. Marshal Service, and alcohol, tobacco, and firearms. All of those agencies together stood at $14.4 billion. ICE got $18 billion. Seems to me we could have found a better way to spend the money. And just as a sidelight, the Congress has never approved the director for the last 6 years, never approved the director of alcohol, tobacco, and firearms, the agency charged with enforcing the federal gun laws, never approved the person in charge because of the influence of the gun lobby. Then this other one shows FBI has sent over 16 million fingerprints received from local law enforcement to the immigration database since the program inception in 2008. More than 900,000, these are their own figures, flagged as potential immigration violators. No information whatsoever regarding what actions are taken, if any, with a set of prints when an arrest is dismissed. And as I said earlier, in New York City, 40% of the arrests are dismissed. But those people are going to have their fingerprints in the database of Homeland Security.
And part of the reason for these soaring numbers is the Obama administration's efforts to show that it's tough on tough on crime, and it is defending the borders.
Yeah, I mean, the Obama administration keeps setting a goal of 400,000 deportations. And the White House press secretary bragged just a day ago that we more than exceeded our goal. We deported in last year 409,000 people. I don't think the public generally has any idea of the number of people. You know, that's, what, 1,200 people a day. And that doesn't include the people that are deported by Border Patrol. You put them in, it's about 715,000. It's about 2,000 people a day.
But again, why is the Obama administration doing this?
Well, I'm not a I'm not a psychologist, but no reflection on psychologists. But I think they're trying to show the hardliners that they're taking a hard line on immigration. But then you see, the first 6 months of 2011, ICE, that's Immigration Customs Enforcement, removed more than 46,000 non-citizens who claim to have a U.S. citizen child. So that child is left here in the States and the parent is removed. As of November 2011, 5,200 children were living in foster care as a result of a parent being deported. So I just think it's important to get this information out to the public and then let the public decide, you know, what they want to do about it.
I mean, the Obama administration would argue that were it not tough on immigration violators, and were did it not, if it had not demonstrated its strength in the enforcement, on the enforcement side of the equation, that it would never have had any chance whatsoever to even begin discussing the possibility of comprehensive immigration reform, which is where we're at now. Do you buy that?
I mean, I understand. I'm sympathetic to the problems of the administration, but I think they can't be involved in really counterproductive activities to try to convince a bunch of nuts that they ought to change immigration laws. I just think that the price is too high.
Who are you referring to when you speak of a bunch of nuts?
I am, you know.
Have you had an opportunity to discuss any of these concerns with elected officials, either here in the city or nationally?
I've had some conversations. I'm going to say something that I've been advised not to say.
But oh, good. Yeah.
And that is that if you have a losing basketball team, you don't fire all the players. You fire the coach. And I think that may be the lesson here.
Who are you talking about?
I leave that to everybody's imagination.
You mentioned the Costa Gavras case, the case of Costa Gavras,
right,
and his daughter. Were there other cases that you handled while you were district attorney that helped focus your mind on the problems of the immigration system?
Well, you know,
and its injustices.
We have this case, I think I mentioned, involving this crooked guy who held himself out as a lawyer. And he took money from people to get them green cards. He sent their names, addresses, and places of employment to ICE. We convicted him, but then ICE proceeded immediately to bring deportation proceedings against the cooperating people. And we said, you know, they've helped us take a bad guy off the street. And they said, sorry, there's no provision in the law. Fortunately, after I left, we found a couple of sensible judges who, on their own initiative, dismissed these cases. But I mean, that's just an idea. There should be a provision in the law. I don't want to see piecemeal legislation, but there should be a provision in the law when somebody cooperates, an immigrant cooperates, to put a crook in jail. They shouldn't immediately be retaliated against by having a deportation proceeding brought against them. I'll give you another example of arbitrariness. There was a young Chinese boy whose parents were here on a green card. When he was 15, he got involved in some robberies, no doubt about it. He was convicted. The judge told him, he's 15 years old, you lead a good life, stay out of trouble, and your record will be removed from the court files, and I'll help you. Well, he went on. He was in the 98th percentile on math score. He went to college. Then he got his education when he was in jail on high school. And he became the vice president of a company. He's 35 years old, and he walks into immigration headquarters and says, I want to get my citizenship now. And they say, thanks a lot for saving us the trouble looking for you. And they arrested him on the ground that he had committed a felony, even though the New York State had expunged that record. They said, we don't care about that. And the judge interceded on his behalf unsuccessfully. It came to me, and I got the governor to issue a pardon. So that really expunged the record. And they very reluctantly released him at midnight in rural New Jersey without telling him where he was or where his family was. Just plain vindictiveness. But that shows you, again, the kind of arbitrary, unreasonable activity that's going on.
In 2007, I believe, you launched the Immigrant Affairs Program in the District Attorney's Office to help immigrants victimized by criminals. What was that program, and why were you compelled to launch it then, in that year, and why not sooner? Why not sooner than 2007?
Should have been sooner. But actually,
what happened? What led to the formation?
Well, I think the business with Costa-Gavras brought the idea, you know, the problem into focus, and but you know, I told all of the immigrants, so they didn't want to cooperate with us; they were afraid, and I told them that we would not turn their names over to ICE. And I stated publicly on a number of programs that I would not turn over any cooperating alien to ICE. And I thought that maybe ICE would come after me, but they never did. it was something. But actually, I mean, it was the only DA's office in the city that did that. And I don't think anybody else has that program, even to this day, but they should.
It still exists in the Manhattan DA's office, correct? It still exists in the Manhattan
DA's office. It still is, yeah. It's still going, but none of the other, I'm trying to get some of the other DA's offices to set it up, but they haven't.
What about elsewhere in the country?
I don't know of any. That doesn't mean there are not any.
And was it effective?
Yes. I mean, we made a number of cases against people who were ripping off immigrants, and that's why we call it the Immigrant Affairs Program, because we were there to help immigrants.
Hmm. How much, if we can talk a little bit about your family, I'm curious to know how much have your feelings about and your approach to immigration issues and immigrant affairs been informed by your family's recent history? And here I'm thinking of, you know, your grandfather's work in calling attention to the suffering of minorities in the Ottoman Empire, and of course to the work that your father did in the Roosevelt administration, particularly with the creation of the War Refugee Board.
Well, I just think you've got to remember where you came from, and it's just very important to help people have the same opportunity that your family did. And my paternal grandfather came here age 10, not speaking a word of English, was able to get into City College 6 years later, had to drop out because his father said you got to help. He was the youngest of 12 children, you have to help support the family. He worked in the law office, got into Columbia Law School at age 18, supported himself by teaching night high school to immigrants. We had night high schools all over the city for immigrants so they could work in the daytime and go to high school at night. So, I mean, the opportunities were there for him, and I just felt that we got an obligation to see that the same opportunities are available to others, and that's a strongly held belief. And, but I mean, so many immigrants have come through the system. You know, something being here at Roosevelt House, something that people don't generally know, there were 15,000 refugees here on visitors visas in 1938. And under the law, you get a visitor's visa, you got to say you intend to return to the place of origin. After Kristallnacht, FDR, by executive fiat, extended all of those visas. One of those people was Albert Einstein. Mm-hmm. But, I mean, there are a lot of people who contributed a lot to the future of the United States. So all of that's important. I still hear from people out of left field saying, you know, your father sponsored me, your grandfather sponsored me. And it's an ongoing business. My father also was key in arranging for those 1,000 refugees to go to Fort Ontario. And it's interesting. In Truman's handwritten diary at Truman Library, he says Secretary Morgenthau should have been impeached. He arranged for those refugees to come here on visitors' visas, knowing they had no intention of returning. That last part was true. he knew that, but it was humanitarian. Effort, but there are pictures in Mrs. Roosevelt's book, and she and my mother went up and visited those refugees at Fort Ontario. So it's something that the family's been interested in. I think every family should be interested.
Mm. Well, this might be an appropriate time to show the video clip.
All right.
And this has absolutely nothing to do with immigration. We're straying off topic, but I promise it's worth it. But it does underscore the connection between the Morgenthaus and the Roosevelts, a relationship that, of course, adds resonance to Mr. Morgenthau's presence in this building tonight. So hang on a second. Don't show it yet, because I would love Mr. Morgenthau to set this up for us. You know what we're about to see. Could you describe what the circumstances were?
Well, FDR had Churchill visiting him. FDR had Churchill visiting him, and he brought him down to my parents' home in Dutchess County on June 20, 1942. And I was already in the Navy, and my destroyer came into Charleston Navy Yard, and I had a weekend pass, so I was home just by chance. And my father liked to take home movies, and he had a camera there, and my sister took these movies. Very interesting that there's not a word at Hyde Park of FDR bringing Churchill down to Fishkill Farms. None of the records show it, but we got the film.
A fill, it would be, you can play it.
Mint juleps. I don't, the president liked my mint juleps, but I don't think Churchill did. He would have run that straight scotch.
This is absolutely remarkable. What did it feel like to you to be in the presence of these great characters? Was it exceptional for you, or were you just accustomed to it?
Yeah, it was exceptional. Churchill asked me three or four times about the Battle of Midway, and I didn't know a goddamn thing about the Battle of Midway. Because when you're on a destroyer, you're on an island, and I couldn't figure out why he was so interested. And it wasn't until much later that I realized that if we had not won the Battle of Midway, FDR couldn't have gone ahead with his plan for Europe first, and that's why it was. Churchill was so interested in why it was so important. As some of you may remember, probably, FDR lost 42 seats in the Congress in 1942 on his program for Europe First. The United States generally was outraged by Japan, and they didn't care that much about Germany, at least a lot of people didn't. So, hadn't won the Battle of Midway, there would have been no second front for a while.
Well, I mean, this is all irresistible stuff, but perhaps we should circle back to immigration, our original purpose. And if you're ready, we can open up the floor to the audience. For questions. So thanks for listening, and if anybody has any questions for us, please fire away.
Saying simply, I think we've been present at a very special occasion. When you see that video clip, and then you look at Mr. Morgenthau and Winston Churchill and Franklin Roosevelt right behind him, you realize that this is a man who has seen so much and has done so much to make our country more just and fair and humane. So I want to thank Mr. Morgenthau, Kirk Semple, for an extraordinarily thoughtful conversation. This is what Roosevelt House is all about.